Hi, I'm Walter Sinnott Armstrong from Duke University, and I'm proud and happy to be presenting some material for the Beginner's Guide to Neural Mechanisms. What this group is trying to do is bring philosophy and neuroscience together, and I love that because I'm in the philosophy department as well as the neuroscience department, and I think that these two fields have a lot to contribute to each other. My particular topic is going to be neuroethics. But what is neuroethics? Well, Adina Roskies, in that picture with her beautiful dog, tells us that there's two branches, neuroscience of ethics and the ethics of neuroscience. The neuroscience of ethics looks at the neural basis of moral judgments. The ethics of neuroscience looks at ethical issues that arise from advances in neuroscience. Now, we're going to look at two examples of the neuroscience of ethics. One, some studies of the neural underpinnings of moral judgments, and two, some questions about whether morality really is a unified field, as many philosophers assume. Then, in the ethics of neuroscience, we're going to look at three topics. We're going to look at attempts to use neuroscience to find consciousness in brain-damaged patients who have been diagnosed as in persistent vegetative states. Then we're going to look at a case of moral responsibility where a tumor makes someone lack control over what they do. And we're going to end by looking at psychopaths and ask whether they are morally responsible. They don't lack control. What they lack is something else that we'll find out. So that's the agenda. And each of these segments will have 10 to 15 minutes of video. You can take a break between them if you want. But let's get right going with the neuroscience of ethics, and we'll focus first on the neural underpinnings of moral judgments. So you can't look at the neural underpinnings of moral judgments until you know what ethics is or what moral judgments are. Now, ethics is a broad field that covers many different things. One topic is normative ethics, which tells us which acts are right or wrong or good or bad or which people have virtues or vices and so on. Now, you can't really get that kind of judgment straight out of science. That would commit the infamous naturalistic fallacy. So most neuroscientists and philosophers don't try to get it directly out of science. Another branch of ethics is descriptive ethics. It's not interested in telling us what's right or wrong, but instead, what do people believe is right or wrong? So it looks at patterns of beliefs, and one of the big issues there is moral relativism. To what extent do our moral judgments vary from culture to culture, or time to time, or individual to individual? Now, the variations that are found raise big questions for meta-ethics, specifically within meta-ethics for the question of whether moral judgments can be objective, or if they are objective, can we know what's right or wrong? Cases like Jyoti Singh, pictured there, suggests that, to many people at least, suggests that, in fact, we can say, I don't care whether people think that's okay, what they did to her was wrong. And that sounds really objective. Moral realists like that. Moral skeptics say either there are no objective moral facts or there are, but we don't know what they are. And the last issue within ethics is the definition of morality. What is common and peculiar to moral judgments? Look at that picture. This person is a glutton. They're displaying gluttony. But is that morally wrong to eat too much and ruin your body that way? A lot of people today would say that's not immoral, that's just stupid because it's going to ruin your health. But where you draw the line between what's immoral and what's imprudent or against your own self-interest, that's not an easy line to draw. So we're going to look first at some studies of descriptive ethics, and then in the next lecture or next segment, we're going to focus on the definition of morality. So let's look at descriptive ethics. Our issue is not going to be how much do moral judgments vary, but instead, what's the psychological and neuroscientific basis of our moral judgments? We're going to start with the old trolley problem, which came from Philip of Foote, and is used by Josh Green and Jonathan Cohen in experiments in 2001, although by others as well. Those two, Josh and Jonathan, are now talking to Alan Alda about the famous trolley problem. So let's listen to what they have to say.
You're standing next to a railroad switch as a train approaches. If you do nothing, the train will surely kill five foolish but innocent people standing on the track. You could save them by hitting the switch, diverting the train. The problem is, there's another foolish innocent standing on the second track.
So the moral question here is it okay to hit the switch so that you only run over one person instead of five? What do you think?
Off the top of my head, it seems it would be regrettable to kill anybody, but if you could save the five people, right, then you would throw the switch.
Well, that's what pretty much everyone we ask says. Okay, now here's a slightly different case.
Right.
Trolley headed towards five people. This time there's no other track. You're on a footbridge, standing over the track, and you're standing next to this big person. And this time, the only way you can save those five people is to push the big guy off of the bridge. He'll land on the tracks. He'll get squashed by the train. He'll die, but the five people will live.
Okay, so would I push the guy off the bridge? Well, it's so hypothetical. I mean, I don't even understand. First of all, I don't understand how he could. I'd have to be really convinced that it could stop the train. But I'd be, as I'm sure most people would be, less inclined to push the guy. I don't know. Depends. It kind of depends. I mean, do I have anything against this guy? I mean, would it matter to me if I lost him?
Yeah.
I mean,
the fact that you're looking for all of these sort of angles and ways out and things to question is very telling, because most people are made rather uncomfortable by that one.
Right.
And
but taking an active role.
Right. Now, these are very similar cases. I mean, it's death by trolley to one person in order to save five people. Perhaps you can try to find a reason for why it's okay and why it's not. And this is what philosophers have been busy doing. Well, we put the philosophical question about what's right and what's wrong aside for a second and say, what's going on in the brain?
What they found when people struggled with these problems in a scanner is that regions of the brain thought to be involved in emotion lit up when people thought about pushing the guy off the bridge. And just as I did, it took them longer to make that decision than the less personal one of throwing the switch.
So you see the problem. Structurally, the two cases are very similar, and yet our moral judgments are very different. Why is that? Philosophers look for some difference between the case that would justify these different moral judgments, but neuroscientists are asking, what is it in our brain that makes us reach different conclusions in these two cases? And the personal case of pushing the person off the footbridge to stop the trolley activates these areas associated with emotion, the medial frontal gyrus, the posterior cingulate, the angular gyrus. But the impersonal, when you're thinking about the impersonal cases, which is pulling the lever to send the trolley on the sidetrack, instead you get areas associated with working memory, like middle frontal gyrus and parietal lobe. Here's the diagram from the original paper in 2001. And that means that those two types of dilemmas are associated with very different brain areas. The differences between these judgments have led people to suggest dual process theories. And the early versions of dual process theories suggested that reason and emotion were the right way to draw the dichotomy. So in the sidetrack case on the top, you can see that the little yellow man is not real happy with pulling the lever to send the trolley on the sidetrack, but they're not yelling and screaming. The emotion's not so much that it overcomes the rational calculation that five lives are more valuable than one, so they end up saying, yes, it's okay. But on the bottom, when you have to push the person, then your emotions yell and scream and send alarm bells off that say you can't do that, and that overpowers the rational and ends up making people say, no, you cannot do that. So the original idea was we have these two processes going for every moral judgment, but in some cases one of them dominates, and in the other cases the other dominates. More recently, in 2013, Molly Crockett and Fari Cushman suggested it's not really about emotion versus reason. Instead, it's about how do we learn these different types of moral judgments. Some things we learn in a model-based way. We construct a model about what's going to happen in the future, and we refine that model in light of information, and then we decide in accordance with which action is going to have the best future outcome. Another way to learn is model-free. Instead of looking to the future and building a model, simply use your experience from the past. When I've done this kind of thing in the past, it hadn't worked out and I've gotten in trouble and people have gotten hurt and so on. And so I'm not going to do that kind of thing now. Notice the model based is looking at consequences. The model free is looking at types of actions. And if you look at the right there in the push scenario, which is pushing the large person off the footbridge, you can see that the model free says, don't push, don't push. Why? Because when you've pushed people in the past, it's created trouble for yourself and for them. Pushing is kind of an act of aggression, and you learn not to do that kind of thing. But in that middle column for the trapdoor scenario, here instead of the trolley going on a sidetrack, the man is falling onto the track, and you're just pulling a lever to open the trapdoor. But you're pulling a lever. And pulling a lever does not typically in the past lead to bad consequences. That's why there's that little picture of a light bulb that you can see in the middle. Because when you flip a switch on the light bulb, it doesn't do anything bad. So you haven't learned through the model-free system that you shouldn't pull levers, and therefore there's less objection, and you end up saying, well, then it's okay to flip. Well, most people end up saying that. And there are many, many variations on this and many, many approaches to it. But this approach, distinguishing model-based from model-free, has really had a big impact on the way people do moral psychology today. Now people are looking more and more about how we learn moral judgments and how that method of learning shapes the moral judgments that we make at present. So that's the first part of the neuroscience of ethics and the end of our first segment.